Welcome to this third lecture about the essentials of the MOOC energy demand in buildings. In this lecture, you will learn how to estimate the hourly and annual heating and cooling energy needs of a building, and you will also learn about the energy needs for domestic hot tap water and electricity. Let's make a step aside before looking again at the energy balance. When designing the energy systems of a building, there are two things we are interested in. The first one is to be able to choose the right size of the heating and cooling equipment expressed in terms of nominal load, also called nominal power or nominal capacity. The second thing you really want to know is about the energy demand and how to minimize it by changing insulation, ventilation, solar factors or internal heat loads. In the end, this energy demand, together with the efficiency of the chosen equipment, will determine your energy costs and energy bill. It is very easy to calculate the energy used by a television, for instance. You only need to multiply its nominal power by the number of hours of use. That is easy because the power of the television is constant. But the power for the space heating and cooling demand depends on outdoor temperature and solar radiation and is changing all time. See here, left, the hourly temperature curve between the beginning of the Dutch spring and the summer, and right, the changes in solar radiation in the same period. Of course, if you are living in a very stable climate, the seasonal difference may be very limited. However, in most climates, we need to make year-round calculations in order to produce good estimates of the energy demand. That is why, in general, we carry out hourly calculations over one whole representative year. If we have hourly temperature and solar radiation data, for instance from a meteorological institute, we can make very easily an energy balance per hour. And if we can make it for 1 hour, we can also make it for more hours and for one complete year. Well, there are 8760 hours in 1 year. Happily enough, we don't need to do this manually. We can use software like Excel or Python or whatsoever. By the way, this is also the principle that is used by most building simulation software like Energy Plus, ESPR, Transys, etc. Let's start with hour one and make the energy balance. If the unbalance is negative, there will be heating needed during this hour. If the unbalance is positive, there will be cooling. In the table right, I've chosen arbitrarily one of them for the sake of demonstration. And we do the same for hour 2 and go further to hour n and finally to hour 8760. We know now for each hour of the year if there is heating or cooling, and the only thing we need to do to get the yearly heating demand is to add all hourly heating demands. And for the annual cooling demand, we add all hourly cooling demands. Quite easy in the end. And this is the result for one specific building, where I found 3,646 kWh annual heating demand and 605 kWh yearly cooling demand. And I also plotted the graphics with all hourly loads. Most important, you see also on the graphic the nominal heating load, also called nominal power. It is the maximum power the equipment should be able to deliver. For the heating, on the left, you see this peak at the end of the year in winter. The peak is 1.6 kilowatts that should be delivered by the heating equipment. Generally, the heating peak takes place at the coldest hour and at night. You see a quite identical peak at the beginning of the year as well, all winter. For the cooling, on the right, you see that the maximum power is achieved in the summer and is 1.8 kilowatt. That should be delivered by the cooling equipment. The price of equipment depends on this nominal load in kilowatt. The energy bills of the residents depend on the annual energy demand in kilowatt hour. However, you may not always have the needed meteorological data to make such calculations. That's why simplified methods can be used. One of the simplified methods is the use of equivalent full load hours. These equivalent full load hours are determined by statistical analysis of the ratio of yearly energy demand and nominal power for a large number of existing buildings. The average ratio of both is what we call the equivalent full load hours. Once you know these full load hours for your region, for the type of building under consideration, you just need to multiply the nominal power of your specific building by the full load hours to get an estimate of its yearly energy demand. Generally, you can find the full load hours in national guidelines. There are three steps. On the left, the steps, on the right, the example of a small apartment. The first step is to calculate the nominal powers for space heating and cooling. To do so for space heating, you will make the energy balance, assuming the coldest outdoor temperature and no solar radiation. For cooling, you will assume the maximum outdoor temperature and the maximum solar radiation and the maximum internal heat gains. In this example, the nominal heating power is 1.8 kilowatt. For the cooling, it is 2.2. The second step is to look in the literature, norms or guides for estimations of the full load hours. For instance, in the Netherlands, for a residential building, the full load hours for heating are around 1500, while there are only 100 for cooling. The last step is to multiply the nominal power by the full load hours, which gives an annual energy demand for space heating of 2700 kilowatt hour. For the cooling, it is 220 kilowatt hour. Quick and dirty estimations, often made by experts with a good feeling for local full load hours. It is also possible to use a method called degree days, but we won't explain it now. Next to heating and cooling energy for space heating, buildings also need energy to heat tap water for showering or doing the dishes. The yearly heating energy demand for hot tap water can be calculated by the equation on this slide. It is 365, which is the number of days in a year, multiplied by the density of water, multiplied by the volume of water in cubic meters. This is dependent on how much water is used, multiplied by the specific heat of water and by the temperature difference between warm and cold water. This gives a result in joule, so we have to divide by 3600 to get it in watt hour. If you wouldn't multiply by 365, you would get daily energy use for hot water instead of yearly energy use. The blue table gives typical volumes of water used in liter per day in US in different types of buildings. This is of course very dependent on local culture, circumstances and climate. In the Netherlands, we assume the temperature of cold water, T-cold, to be 10 degrees on average, quite equal to the average ground temperature. But of course, in winter, it may be much colder, around 5 degrees, and in summer, much warmer, around 20 degrees Celsius. But for this type of estimate, using the average yearly air temperature of a location will give quite a reasonable approximation of the average T-cold for estimation of the yearly energy demand for hot tap water. Do be aware that this will be inaccurate on a day level. A temperature T-hot of 45 to 50 degrees Celsius is enough to deliver hot water. However, many systems are continuously heated to 60 degrees to avoid the growth of Legionella. Just like for space heating, you also need the nominal heating load, which is the peak load, to size the hot tap water equipment. It is the maximum energy rate and is therefore obtained for the maximum volume flow rate. In general, this maximum volume flow rate is between 0.1 and 0.16 liters per second in residential buildings. In general, the annual heating energy for hot tap water is much smaller than the space heating energy, but for the peak load, it is the reverse. The nominal power for hot tap water is in general much larger than the nominal power for space heating. Next to the thermal needs, which are the needs for heat and cold, there is also a need for electricity. For those from countries that also use electricity to cool or heat, that may be a bit confusing. Using electricity for cooling and heating is only one of the ways of doing that, as you will see in the course Energy Supply Systems for Buildings. That is the reason why we don't count the heat and cold demand as electricity demand. However, there are a few processes in a building for which electricity is really needed. There is not really another option. These processes are lighting, powering domestic appliances like computers and fridges, and powering the ventilators when mechanical ventilation is used. Let's start with lighting. The table shows frequently used values for nominal powers for lighting per square meter floor area. Note that the values are the same as in the slide about internal heat gains. This allows to calculate the total lighting power, another word for the nominal load, if all lights are on. See the first formula on the right. To calculate the total annual electricity demand, you need to multiply this power by the number of hours the lighting is on, Ha lighting in the second equation. For a quick estimation, you can assume, for example, that all lights are on for 50% of the time, which is equal to 4089 hours a year. In the equation, there is also a correction factor, gamma. This correction factor takes into account that not all lights are always on. For example, sometimes only half of the lights are on because not all rooms of the building are occupied or because there is enough daylight. Concerning the electrical appliances, we can apply the same type of rules. The second table shows frequently used values for nominal powers for appliances per square meter floor area. Here too, the values are identical to the ones of internal heat gains. In the end, the total electrical power is dissipated into heat. The nominal power and annual energy use can be calculated exactly the same way as for lighting. Of course, if you know which appliances are present, you can refine your calculations by using the real actual power of each of them. And finally, we have to power the ventilators, if any. The power needed by ventilators is the air volume flow rate multiplied by the pressure drop through the ventilation system divided by the efficiency of the ventilator. Typical pressure drops will be something between 200 and 800 Pascal, although values above 1000 are also found. It fully depends on the pressure drop in the air ducts and therefore on the length of the air ducts and the number and type of bends in these ducts, their size and the volume flow rates. For quick calculations, you can assume that in small building with only supply or exhaust ventilators, the pressure drop is 200 Pascal. If the ventilation has mechanical exhaust and supply, that will be around 400 Pascal. In a large building, if the ducts are very long and there are a lot of vents, this could amount 400 Pascal for a single exhaust or supply system and a double for a system with mechanical exhaust and supply. For quick estimations of the annual electrical demand, you can assume that the ventilator is on for 70% of the time, which is 6132 hours. In the end, the annual demand for electricity is therefore the sum of electricity needed by lighting, appliances, and ventilators. Thank you for listening to the essentials of energy demand in buildings. You know now how to estimate the energy needed to heat and cool buildings. You also know about the heat demand for domestic hot tap water, and you are aware of the electricity needs in buildings. I hope you have enjoyed this course. For detailed information, calculation methods, and energy saving possibilities, see the complete course Energy Demand in Buildings. Goodbye, and thank you for your attention.